Friends, please stand if you're able and join me in our call to worship this morning. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. And all who fear God say, his love endures forever.
Hosanna to God. Hosanna in the highest.
We shall triumph over those who surround us and stand in confidence in the Lord our God.
Hosanna to God. Hosanna in the highest.
The Lord is our strength and our might. The Lord has become our salvation. Please remain standing and join us in our hymn of praise this morning, Hosanna, loud Hosanna. Amen. Grace and peace in the name of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Good morning. Welcome to Elevation United Methodist Church this special Sunday, Palm Sunday, where we celebrate the triumphal entry of Jesus Christ into Jerusalem. Glad you are here this morning. Glad you're worshiping with us at home. My name is Clay Parker. I'm the pastor here. And if you are visiting with us this morning, please take a moment to fill out one of the visitor cards you'll find in the pews and place it in the altar plate a little bit later so that we can make sure we get back in touch with you later this week and let you know how thankful we are that you were here with us this morning. Friends, let's affirm our faith together by sharing in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You to turn to your neighbor on your left and your right, share the peace of Christ which passes all understanding. And kingdom kids, come on down. Kingdom kids, come on down. Hey, what's up, Madison? Here, come around this way over here. Thanks, baby girl. Hey, Claire. Hey, Annie. How are y'all? Did you have fun at the race last week? That was fun, wasn't it? You had one already? Very cool. We're going to do one after church, you know. I'm excited. Hey, Everett. Oh, boy. Gonna sit right next to brother. There's Sophia. Hey, Sophia, you want to come on down? Come on, girl. Come on, it's okay. You don't want to come down? Okay. Put her on the spot. Mia, you want to come down? Maybe she'll come with you, Mia. I know you see them, don't you? So if they can come down whenever they want to. Hey, so let me ask you a question. Do you ever hear this at home? So if mommy or daddy ask you to do something, or grandma, granddaddy, aunt and uncle, whatever the case may be, if they ask you to do something, and you might go, well why? And what's the typical response? What do they usually say? That's right, because I said so. That's right, right? Yeah. So this morning we're gonna hear about a time where Jesus says that, and he didn't say that very often in the scriptures, right? Usually he gave a reason and a story, a parable about why he wanted the disciples and why he wanted us to do something. Y'all come on up here if you want to. Come on, scoot up. Yeah, it's all good. And but this morning, he needs to make sure that he's got a donkey to ride in on as he enters Jerusalem, right? So he tells the disciples to go, and there you're going to find a donkey that's never been ridden before. And I want you to untie it. It didn't belong to the disciples now. But he said, I want you to untie it and bring it to me. And if the owners say, why are you untying this donkey? You tell them, because the Lord needs it. That's all he said. He didn't give them a story. He didn't give them a reason. He said, because the Lord needs it. So do you think they went and untied that donkey? Yeah, yeah, they did. And guess what? Those people said, hey, why are you untying our donkey? And they said, because the Lord needs it. And they were like, okay, cool. So donkeys are pretty cool, right? Mr. Peter, show us. We got a couple of pictures of donkeys up there. Look, there's one. Can you see that one? You can look back there and see it if you want to. Yep, there's one. There's a couple of the smaller ones. Yeah, those are cute. And then I think we got one. Look, there's several of them there, right? We're going to talk about this in a little bit. They actually like to be in a herd. They're herd animals. We'll talk about that in just a minute. And then, oh, how in the world did that guy get up there? Who was that? Oh, it's Donkey from Shrek. Yeah, it is. Okay. He talks. I don't know. There was a talking donkey in Balaam, but I don't know. Yeah, I don't know who put that up there. I don't know. But he got up there, didn't he? But listen, donkeys are cool, right? I love seeing them. They're really neat. There's a bunch around here. You can see them in all kinds of places out here, all kinds of farm pastures. Yeah, they're neat, right?
There's brown, there's white, and gray.
Yeah, they've got different colors. So why did Jesus, do you think, ride in on a donkey? Why did he ride in on it? Why didn't he ride in on a big, majestic, white horse? And I'm Jesus! Why didn't he do that? Why did he ride in on a donkey and just kind of rode walking along? Why did he do that? You don't know? I think it was because he knew he was the kind of king who came to serve, right, and not be served. He was humble, right? And also riding in on that donkey, have you ever heard us talk about fulfilling prophecy? That's a big word. Well, somebody named Zechariah talked about it in the Old Testament way before Jesus was even born. And so Jesus riding on this donkey made what Zechariah wrote come true. That's what fulfilling prophecy kind of means, right? So it's important to celebrate donkeys today. We want to celebrate donkeys. Because without a donkey, we wouldn't have the triumphal entry, right? Jesus wouldn't have had anything to ride on. So I want us to celebrate the donkey. And we're going to talk about this morning how we can be more like a donkey as we become better disciples, okay? So I want to give each one of you a picture. So So there you go, sweet girl. You got it? This is a picture that an artist drew of Jesus riding on a donkey. So this week, you can put that up on your refrigerator. You can on your wall. You can put it in your... an artist made it, yes. You can put it... They didn't have pictures back then, that you can put it in your notebook. You can do whatever you want to with it. Here, will you pass those out for me, Haley? Let everybody get one over there. And I want you to remember, when you're looking at it, that Jesus is the king who rode in on a donkey and not on the back of a big white horse, right? Can you remember that?
Or black.
Or black, yeah. Can you remember that? Cool, I bet you can too. Can we pray real quick? You guys repeat after me, okay? Dear God, thank you for your son, Jesus, who rode in on the back of a donkey. Help us to remember that Jesus is our King. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you guys can go back to your seat. And if anybody else would like one of these, just let me know and I'll get you one. Older disciples. So we transition, we pivot into our time of Jesus sightings and prayer requests. I've got several prayer requests that I want to lift up this morning. And first is Harry Johnson. Harry is Dallas's brother, Nancy's brother-in-law. And Harry's going to be having, many of you know, he is a paraplegic, and he is going to be having some pretty significant surgery on his foot on Tuesday. So please lift Harry Johnson and Dallas and Nancy as well in your prayers, but particularly Harry for his surgery, which is coming up on Tuesday. Phyllis Thornton is requesting some unspoken prayers for her family, so we certainly lift those up. Ashley, I believe this is your handwriting. Brittany Whedon, is that the correct? Brittany Whedon had a bug bite, and now she's fighting for her life due to a serious infection. So what kind of bug? Was it a... Okay, yeah. My goodness. So she's on life support, and so we want to pray for Brittany and her family, and just pray that God is the God of miracles, and pray that that miracle will happen for Brittany. So we lift that up. And Chris Brown will be starting some new cancer treatment. And we want to lift up David Tutton as well. David will be going tomorrow for a stress test, prayerfully it will show that there are no issues, but if there are issues, he'll have to have some procedures for his heart. And so we lift up David and his lovely wife as well. And, she is concerned about that, obviously, and driving back and forth to Durham. And so we want to just continue to keep them in our prayers as well. Are there any other Jesus sightings or prayer requests that we want to lift up this morning? Hold on a second, Ronnie. Hey, Don, will you come down here and grab this after? There you go. Thank you. Go ahead.
My nephew, Reggie Batty.
Okay.
He, last two or three days ago, he was at home, and I guess he got an aneurysm, and he's like a vegetable in Lake Norman Hospital in ICU, and so he's unable to move anything. He's going to be not able to do anything, and so they're waiting to see what the test results are and everything, but he's only 43 years old.
Oh, my goodness.
Has one small little girl who's 40 years old.
Okay.
So I need to pray for him and his wife.
Absolutely.
And little girl.
Absolutely. So we pray for Reggie Batty. B-A-T-T-Y? Is that?
B-A-T-T-Y.
Okay. Suffered an aneurysm. We certainly lift him and his family up in prayers. Any other prayer requests this morning or Jesus sightings? Phyllis, we'll get Betty Ruth first, then we'll get you, Phyllis.
Unspoken.
Yes, ma'am, Betty Rose. I said Betty Ruth. I knew a Betty Ruth. That's funny. Betty Rose, unspoken. Yes, ma'am.
A former co-worker, Susie Carter, had a stripe this way.
Thank you, Phyllis. Any others this morning? Well, we give thanks for a God who can handle all of these prayer requests, the written, the prayer list, the unspoken, and can handle so much more. And so we begin, as we always do this morning, our time of prayer by going to God in a posture of silence so that we can listen for that still small voice. Listen for the whispering, the groaning of the Holy Spirit. And so I invite you to do that just now as we go to God in prayer. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we are so thankful to be in the house of the Lord today. So thankful to have this opportunity to worship and to lift up our voices together in praise of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. So thankful to be able to celebrate His triumphal entry into Jerusalem, marking the beginning of Holy Week. A week where sadly we will hear the shouts of Hosanna turn to the shouts of Crucify Him. As we somberly remember and recognize the death of our Savior on the cross, but thankfully, as I heard a preacher say one time, that is not the period at the end of the story. We are able to celebrate on Easter Sunday next week, the resurrection of our Lord and Savior. But we don't want to get too far ahead of ourselves, oh God, because today is a day of celebration. This upcoming week is a week of celebration. But we are indeed thankful for a Savior who gives us the promise not only of eternal life with You when our short time here on earth is through, but the gift, the promise of new life, a transformed life, in and through Jesus Christ when we surrender our will for His and become one of His disciples. Lord Jesus shared many names that He would go by with us. Wonderful Counselor, Prince of Peace, Light of the World. And yet Great Physician gives us so much hope. And so we want to lift up all of our folks this morning who are in need of healing, who are in need of that touch from our Great Physician. We claim complete healing in His precious name and submit fresh and new to work with You so that we can share the kingdom of heaven here on earth. Lord, as we continue in this time of worship, as we prepare to hear Your Holy Word, as we prepare to hear a message of hope, as we prepare to sing Your songs, we just pray that everything is pleasing and acceptable in Your sight, O Lord. We love You and we praise You. And we do this and so much more in the name of Jesus, who taught His disciples and who continues to teach us to pray this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
This morning, let us worship with our tithes and our offerings. There are also different ways of giving that are listed on the screen for those who are joining us on Zoom. and on Facebook. But now let us worship with our tithes and our offerings. We come to you this morning bringing back our gifts that you bestowed upon us. And Lord, we ask that these gifts be given unto you to do your work and to do your will throughout the community, throughout the world. In thy name we pray, and all of God's people said, amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Together for the prayer for illumination. Merciful God,
as we enter Holy Week, turn our hearts again to Jerusalem and to the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Stir up within us the gift of faith that we may not only praise him with our lips, but may follow him in the way of the cross. Amen.
Now join me in the reading from the Old Testament, from Psalms 118, first and second verse, and verse 9 through 29, or 19
through 29.
19 through 29. Okay. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you. Give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God and has given us light. Bind the festal procession. Excuse me. With branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will exalt you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Our gospel lesson this morning is found in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 19, verses 28 through 40. After telling this story, Jesus went on toward Jerusalem, walking ahead of his disciples. As he came to the towns of Bethpage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives, he sent two disciples ahead. Go into that village over there, he told them. And as you enter it, you will see a young donkey tied there that no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks, why are you untying that colt, just say, the Lord needs it. So they went and found the colt just as Jesus had said. And sure enough, as they were untying it, the owners asked them, why are you untying that colt? And the disciples simply replied, the Lord needs it. So they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their garments over it for him to ride on. As he rode along, the crowds spread out their garments on the road ahead of him. When he reached the place where the road started down the Mount of Olives, all of his followers began to shout, to sing as they walked along, praising God for all the wonderful miracles they had seen. Blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in highest heaven. But some of the Pharisees among the crowd said, Teacher, rebuke your followers for saying things like that. He replied, if they kept quiet, the stones along the road would burst into cheers. This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on all of us gathered here, those of us worshiping at home. Empower the words of my mouth, the collective meditation of all our hearts, so that together they might be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. For you, O Lord, are our rock and our redeemer. In Jesus' name. Amen. In a 2011 blog post, Brian McLaren, who's an American pastor and author of countless books, engaged in an imaginative exercise. He retells the Palm Sunday story, from the perspective of those who expected a military and a political savior. What if Palm Sunday had happened that way, he wonders, as a carefully planned assault on Roman Jerusalem, rather than the triumphal yet tragic image of Jesus perched upon his donkey that we read about in this morning's text from Luke. Operation Sacred Vengeance would be the name of the rebel campaign. Jesus and his disciples have engaged in careful preparation, storing caches of weapons, arranging for relays of horses, establishing communications with zealot factions who are awaiting the signal to rise up and sow chaos in the streets, preparing the way for their military assault. As McLaren tells it, Jesus mounts a white horse, or a black one, Skyline. He is carrying a huge sword, but has it hidden in a palm branch. His disciples are similarly well armed with swords, daggers, and shields, all camouflaged behind palm branches. They are mounted on war horses, prepared for battle. The word goes out and the crowds assemble, and each man's right hand is a sword or a dagger raised to the sky, concealed beneath in a palm frond or a cloak. Each left hand is raised in a fist. As they cross the brow of the hill near Bethany and the city comes into view, Jesus gives a rousing speech. It is wrong for the heathen idolaters to have power over the faithful people of God, he shouts. That wrong must end today. We have suffered enough. Now we will make our persecutors suffer. The people cheer and chant, victory, victory. Crush the Romans. Kill the collaborators. Who is with me in our holy cause? Jesus asks. The crowd shout, we are, in a roar that echoes across the valley into the streets of Jerusalem. Who is willing to fight to the death and avenge the blood of our ancestors? Again, the crowd shout, we are. And who will shed a gallon of Roman blood for every drop of our blood that is shed? Again, the crowd erupts. And then the branches and coats are thrown to the ground, and blades glisten in the sun. I see the uneasiness on many of your faces as you read that account or hear that account. If that makes you uncomfortable, you're not alone. I think the uneasiness we feel is part of what McLaren was going for. Because we know, of course, that this was not the way that it happened. But it is the way that a lot of folks thought that it might happen. They thought their Messiah, their Mashiach, their anointed deliverer, was going to free them from the hands of the Roman oppressors, free them from the bondage they had been living under. But that's not what our Messiah came to do, at least not the way that McLaren writes about. Jesus came to bring good news to the poor, recovery of sight to the blind. He came to let the oppressed go free. And this day in Jerusalem, the people seem to be all in with their desire to receive this message. This day they would lay their cloaks on the road so that Jesus could pass, and they would proclaim, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And their king, our king, he didn't ride in on the back of a majestic white steed. No, our king rode in on the back of a young colt, one that had never been ridden. We often see it depicted as a donkey, and it's a pretty safe assumption that it was a donkey. For one thing, donkeys were not as expensive as horses. Horses were for more of an elite crowd than the villagers that the disciples would visit that day. And the donkey's very origin is from the desert areas of the world. But the donkey is also important because it is a fulfillment of prophecy. We'll talk more about that in just a second. And when the disciples began to untie the colt and they were asked, as Jesus told them they might be, "What's going on here?" They responded the way Jesus told them to respond. The Lord needs it. The Lord needed that donkey to accomplish the mission of the day, to announce his otherworldly kingship to the folks gathered in the holy city. And church, the Lord needs us as well to accomplish the commission he gave his disciples, the commission that we all share in, the commission to make disciples for the transformation of the world. And I think he needs us all to be a little more donkey-like as we do just that. So Luke's recounting of the triumphal entry is a little different than some of the other gospel evangelists. There's no mention, first of all, of what? Palm branches. No mention of the palm branches in Luke's account. No mention of the shouts of Hosanna. But what we do have mentioned that we see in the other writings of the gospel evangelist is the mention of the colt. This mentioning of the colt, of the donkey, is, as I mentioned briefly before, one of prophecy being fulfilled. Zechariah talks about it in the 9th chapter of his prophetic text. Rejoice, O people of Zion. Shout in triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, yet he is humble, riding on a donkey. Riding on a donkey's colt. So here's your duh statement of the day. If God thought it was important to speak to the prophet Zechariah and for Zechariah to share this with the Israelites and with us, then it's probably pretty important for us to hear today. And I think it's important because the donkey has many traits that we as disciples should be striving to emulate as we follow Jesus. And it's not just the obvious picture of humility. That lasting image we all have of the lowly beast of burden carrying our humble Savior. Being humble is a no-brainer as we walk with the Lord. But besides being humble, did you know that donkeys are not easily startled, unlike horses? And they have a keen sense of curiosity. I want to touch on that keen sense of curiosity first. You know, as disciples, we can't be content with only sitting inside the four walls of this beautiful worship space on Sunday mornings. We need to have a curious streak running through us. We need to be constantly wondering what's going on in our communities. What can we do to share the love of Christ in the places we're called to be curious about? Now, to flip that just a little bit, I do think we need to be curious about this place too, about Elevation United Methodist Church. We need to be curious about thinking about fresh new ways that we can reach and serve the people that gather here every Sunday morning so that they can be empowered and strengthened to have their own curious streak about what's going on in their communities. You know, curiosity is often, and I think it's unfortunate, but it's often thought about in terms of a child, right? Enriching that child's curiosity by reading to them, by sharing stories with them. But I think that we adults could stand to be a little more curious when it comes to what's going on in our communities. We need to be a little more curious about how we can be better disciples. And we also need to learn to embrace this newfound curiosity, because as we do that, we can't be easily startled. Right? We can't be easily startled, because I promise you, you will see things that will cause you to be startled. You will see injustices and wrongs that will not only startle you, they may make you throw up your hands and say, enough, I can't do it. But church, Jesus didn't ride into Jerusalem that day announcing his kingship. Jesus didn't continue that journey on to the cross so that we could give in to that feeling of being startled and disoriented and give up. Our King gives us the strength to shed the light of justice on the injustices we see and to right the wrongs in his holy name. But you know, standing up to and shedding light on these injustices, well, they'll require us to be a little stubborn too. Did you know donkeys have a reputation for stubbornness? Yeah. It's difficult to force a donkey into doing something it sees as contrary to its own best interest or safety. Y'all, when we look at the great commission to make disciples by sharing the grace and the love of our King as being in our best interest, it's clear that we can all use a little bit more of that donkey stubbornness in our lives. Because without that stubbornness, we would give in or give up on that proposition at the very first sign of trouble. Now, if stubborn seems like a word that doesn't have a holy tone to it, how about resolute? Does that sound more churchy? Whatever you want to call it, you need it. Because churchy, because we will be frightened on this discipleship pathway. We will be tempted every day to do things contrary to the will of God. We will want to walk down that wide road of the world and jump off the narrow road of discipleship every opportunity we have. And when those times do pop up in our lives, we have to rely on the resolute grace of Jesus to empower us to be better disciples. And just like everything else that we do, as his disciples, Jesus gives us this model of holy stubbornness that we need to exhibit in our lives. The one who was rebuked, mocked, spat upon, laughed at, and yet continued the mission to love us and share grace with us, is the same Savior who empowers us to be stubborn in the face of adversity. But church, as you have heard from me and from others many times before, we can't carry out this mission of the King alone. You see, donkeys are herd animals. When I learned that, it made me a little sad to walk by and see all the donkeys that we see solo in these fields around here, because they're herd animals. They long to be together. They don't like being kept by themselves. Donkeys have an innate desire to be a part of a herd. Donkeys recognize the strength that comes from being around other donkeys. And sisters and brothers, we must be aware of the truth that we share the same need. God did not create the donkey to be a solitary creature. And God did not create us to be solitary creatures either. We shouldn't like being kept on our own, but many times we feel as though, particularly when it comes to our witness, that I'm just better off doing it by myself. Friends, there's a reason that Jesus called 12 disciples. There's a reason that they were told, and that we in turn are told, to go into the world and to make more disciples. Jesus knew then, now, and forevermore that the world needs a community of strong women and men, children and adults, all united in the common goal of loving the folks with the same love that our Savior loved us with. in his classic book, Life Together, The Exploration of Christian Community. German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote, "A Christian fellowship lives and exists by the intercession of its members for one another, or it collapses. I can no longer condemn or hate a brother for whom I pray, no matter how much trouble he causes me. His face, that hitherto may have been strange and intolerable to me, is transformed in intercession into the countenance of a brother for whom Christ died, the face of a forgiven sinner." Church, when we look at our sisters and our brothers through that lens, we will be stronger. We will gain strength together. We will have the firm foundation of Jesus strengthening us so we won't collapse. And we will be transformed together. So, church, I pray that we will begin to take on the traits of the donkey. That we will be curious and not easily startled. That we will exhibit that holy stubbornness as we walk with the Lord, and that we will always remember that we are stronger together, stronger when we are a part of the herd. Jesus needed that young donkey some 2,000 years ago, and our Savior needs you too. May we all be a little more donkey-like as we seek to make disciples and share light and love in the communities where we are called to serve. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Excuse me. Amen. Friends, if we will stand together, we're going to sing a hymn that I love. It's excuse me, probably one of your favorites as well. And as we sing Tell Me the Stories of Jesus, I remind you that the altar is open to come and kneel and cry out, to come and lament and pray, to simply come and be in the presence of God. There is comfort to be found at the foot of the cross. So let's stand and sing together, Tell Me the Stories of Jesus. And friends, receive this benediction and this blessing. as you leave this place, strengthened and empowered by the grace of our Savior Jesus Christ, look for the opportunities where you can share light and love in your community, giving thanks for a humble king who made his triumphal entry on the back of a donkey. We ask these things in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, you may be seated for just a moment. We'll share some brief announcements. And then as we head down to the fellowship hall, Linda Clifton will kind of guide us there for what we need to do next as we prepare for our Easter egg hunt and then our hot dog lunch together. Absolutely, brother. Yay, Colin says. Yes, sir. It is going to be fun, and we're looking forward to that. So let's share some announcements very briefly. I call your attention to the announcements in the back, and you all can certainly read over those. I do want to remind everybody that upcoming with me is at Grill on the Hill now on Monday mornings at 9 o'clock. So we'd love to have you come join us then. Remember, Kingdom Kids and Mustard Seed Children's Choir. Linda, I'm going to assume that y'all are not meeting the next 2 weeks, correct? Right. So April 24th, we'll be back for Mustard Seed and Children's Choir. And Linda, we'll talk about this a little later. You guys may have to meet in the outreach building that day because little Callie's birthday party is that day in the fellowship hall. So we're excited about that. Upper rooms are here. You may have noticed that when you walked in. So a new upper room is available for you. We've got them up at the vestibule. And on both of our exits here, you can see the new upper rooms. Again, our Easter egg hunt and hot dog lunch directly after worship. So we'll head down to the fellowship hall. Linda will get us organized. Our children will have a craft and a story from Miss Sue. We're excited about that. We'll hide Easter eggs. We'll go on our hunt, and then we'll share together in a meal in the fellowship hall. So we look forward to all that here in just a little bit. I do want you to pay particular attention to this next opportunity that we have to serve at the Bama Food Pantry. Okay, Wednesday, May the 4th. And so may the 4th be with us all. Yeah, right? Thank you, Beverly. As we go and as we serve our community, y'all, I'm not trying to make anybody feel bad or you know, anything like that. I know we have to work. I know we have commitments. But I'm just telling y'all the truth and a fact. We had one person come from Elevation United Methodist Church the last time that it was our Wednesday to serve at the food pantry. Testing. 1, 2. Is this on? No. It's on. One person. Come on, y'all. Right? We can do better than that. You got till May 4th to make arrangements. You don't have to take a whole day off from work. You're there for about 2.5, 3 hours, tops. Did I mention we had one person show up the last time that it was our time to do food pantry? May the 4th, right? All right, May the 4th. And we'll talk about that more as we get closer to that time. And then please pay particular attention to our Holy Week services. This Thursday, Maundy Thursday at 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary. Our Good Friday service will be at 12 o'clock noon here in the sanctuary on Good Friday. And then we have two opportunities for Easter morning worship, 7 o'clock a.m. adjacent to the cemetery, the graveyard, for our sunrise service with a light breakfast to follow after that. And then at 9:30, our traditional Easter worship here in the sanctuary. So invite a friend and come and join us for all of those opportunities for worship next week. We're excited about that. So we want to lift up a couple of birthdays today. We want to lift up Justin Huff, whose birthday is April 16th, and Bunny O'Hara. Her birthday is also April 16th as well. So let's give a big round of applause to those birthdays. And then we have a few anniversaries as well. Mike and Marianne Lynch, their anniversary is today, April 10th. Eric and Amy Fan's anniversary is tomorrow, April 11th. And then Ross and Lane McLam's anniversary is April 16th. Are there any birthdays or anniversaries for the upcoming week that we need to add to our list? All right. Well, friends, I'll say a blessing later over our hot dog lunch and our time together. So I invite you now to rise up as one and go down to the fellowship hall, and we'll get you situated and organized. And kids, y'all will have a fun craft and story time with Miss Sue, and then we'll do our Easter egg hunt. And I'll join you down there in just a minute.